Morning, church. It's good to see everyone here this morning, and for those of you joining us at home, it's nice to have you with us too. I'm just going to go ahead and do a psalm reading for us. It's Psalm 63, verses 1 through 4. O God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you, as in a dry and weary land where there is no water. So I have looked upon you in the sanctuary, beholding your power and glory. Because your steadfast love is better than life, my lips will praise you. So I will bless you as long as I live. In your name, I will lift up my hands. And now Randy will lead us in our time of worship.
Thank you, Kurt. It says in Psalm 95, the Lord is a great God, the great King. Let's sing together, Come Thou Almighty King, number 8 in your songbooks. Let's stand together. We're going to sing another song of praise to the Lord. It says in Isaiah 63, You, O Lord, are our Father, our Redeemer from of old. Let's sing together. We praise thee, O God, our Redeemer. Number 68. Now, let's turn to those around us and welcome them and say, good morning. God bless you. Thank you, everybody. We're going to rehearse in 2 weeks from now. We'll sing the last Sunday of the month. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Oh, it's good to see you today. Good to see you smiling and talking to one another. What a blessing that is. I have a few announcements for us that I pray that we'll listen and take part in. Tonight at 5 o'clock, rather than having our worship and witness service here, we're having our Love One Another potluck. And boy, is it going to be a potluck. It's going to be a great time, and it's going to be a great time because you're bringing all the food. And so we know it's going to be good. If you haven't signed up, we have a sign-up outside. If your last name begins with A through F, you bring a side dish. If it's G through L, you bring a salad. If it's M through Z, you bring a main dish. I'm bringing my Cheerios casserole, so I think it'll be real good. Secondly, we're having a baptism on March the 13th, and if you have not followed the Lord and what God's word would call believers' baptism, one of the pastors, would be more than happy to talk with you about this wonderful time that you will be doing. And so please come and see Pastor Jared, myself, or Jeremy, that we might share with you about what baptism really means. Youth children baptism class next week, right after the service. So if you have a child who's interested in baptism, or a young person, next Sunday after our morning service, please have them come and meet down here. Ben, lead us, please.
Hello, good morning. So nice to see your faces from this angle. Usually I'm over there. So yesterday I got a 10-day worship leaders conference, and one of the verses that we got to meditate on for that, our sessions, were from Colossians 3:16, where it says, "Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God." So let's do that together. Will you stand with us? Find in me thy all in all. new song that we're going to sing this morning is just so appropriate for what we're learning through Jared's teaching in the book of Hebrew about how Jesus is better. We've listed those so far. Better than the angels. Amen. Better than whatever the world has to offer, and we're going to discover all these things and more. So this song is called Jesus is Better.
Oh,
we thank you for who you are and for what you've done for us. And there's nothing better. And so we declare that this morning. I just ask that you would speak through Jared this morning as he brings us the word. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen, amen. No one, nothing is better than who?
Jesus.
Amen, amen. Man, great worship time this morning, choir, praise team. What a blessing we've been able to share together already this morning. Now, I hope that the sermon matches what we just did, because I'm a little afraid. I'm going to be honest with you. Today might be a downer. I'm just going to confess that right from the get-go, because it's a warning passage. And it's not something that we want to hear, perhaps, today, that we might actually be neglecting Jesus. Anybody feel like they're neglecting Jesus today? No. Well, praise the Lord. None of you are raising your hands. Either that or you're all lying. But anyway, it's going to be good because it's God's word, and he's going to speak to us. Amen? Amen. Now, I just want to remind you that we have 20 children, junior high age, and their leaders up at camp right now. They're going to be heading back sometime this afternoon, so be praying for them. I've heard good reports that they've had a great time up there and just really growing in the Lord and just experiencing his beauty and his creation and also growing closer to one another. So let's pray for our junior hires and their leaders as they make their way home. Now, as you know, I am prone to do, I went ahead and I consulted good old Webster today to find out the definition for the word neglect. Neglect means this. This is according to Webster. To give little attention or respect to disregard, as in basically the building has been neglected for years, so no wonder it's falling apart. All right, anybody have a home that looks, okay, anyways. How about the second one? It's to leave undone or unattended to, especially through carelessness. As in, the prison guard neglected his duty, so no wonder there are crazy convicts running the streets. Yeah, okay. Now, while neglect is something that we don't often admit, the reality is this, that we neglect stuff every day. How many of you may at times neglect to water your plants? What happens to said plants? They die, right? My wife made sure to remind us, as she's up at camp, to not neglect the feeding and walking and taking care of her baby, aka our dog Frodo. We have not neglected Frodo, but if you neglect your pets, what happens to your pets? Sometimes we neglect to take care of our health, like when we eat too many French fries. Okay? I don't relate to any of these things, by the way. We neglect to take care of our minds by watching too many mindless videos on YouTube or spending hours on Facebook. Oh, scrolling, must scroll more, must like more. Yee, scary. We neglect to take care of our relationships by not relating to our relatives. Oh boy, you guys are a tough crowd today. Come on, y'all. And sadly, at times, though, in all seriousness, we neglect our spiritual lives by failing to keep our eyes firmly fixed on Jesus, right? It's easy to kind of get our eyes focused on other things. And that's why we need to be reminded over and over again that Jesus is better, so that we ought to fix our eyes on him. Before we dig in today, just last week, the author of Hebrews took us on this tour through these Old Testament texts, if you remember, declaring that Jesus is better than the angels. And today we're going to take a break from that and get this first warning passage, namely, don't neglect this great salvation. Or we want to say, don't neglect Jesus, the author of that salvation. Let's go ahead and bow in prayer and ask his blessing. Lord, we thank you that you have brought us here this morning. The very fact that we're here means that we do, there's something that has drawn us here. And my prayer is that it's not something that is not you. My prayer is that you are why we are here today. That we are not neglecting this salvation, this calling that you placed upon us. Lord, I pray that we will fix our eyes firmly and completely on you. We will recognize once again that you are indeed better than anything this world has to offer. And that you will really just draw us into your presence today. Illumine your word for us by your spirit, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So we are coming to the first of what is many warning passages that the author of Hebrews sprinkles throughout his doctrinal dissertation, really, on who Jesus is and how he's better than other things. And so this is the first one. Now, if you remember the purpose that we stated for the book of Hebrews a couple weeks ago when we went through our introduction, we said this, that the author of Hebrews wrote to warn his audience. So really one of the main reasons he wrote was to warn them. And what do we say? That it was to reject the Jewish teachings and to persevere in the faith by keeping their eyes fixed on Jesus, who is better, right? And today we're keying in on that warning aspect. Much like last week, we had to preface the morning with some thoughts on how the author of Hebrews uses the Old Testament. Today, I want to remind us of some of the reasons why he has to come in and warn us and what these warning passages are all about. When we did that introduction a few weeks back, this is what we learned about the warnings. Number one, frequency equals urgency. Now, you've all heard the phrase, right? The squeaky wheel gets the grease, right? The squeaky wheel gets the grease. And so what's squeaky here? Why does the author have to keep, you know, applying grease to this wheel? Something is going on. Something that needs to be reminded of and warned about. And so that frequency then equals the urgency of it. Now, the author uses the phrase, let us, to do this implicitly many times throughout. Let us do this, or let us do this, or let us do this. But he also gives very strict commands, and he warns his audience by using these imperatives, direct commands, and today is one of those days. This is a very direct, pointed command, and don't we all love it when that happens? How many of you like it when mom or dad says, no, don't do this, or you got to do that, right? Well, this is one of those moments, so get ready. Get ready. Now, the goal of these warnings, it's not to just simply inform the audience of theological doctrines, right? That's not the purpose fully of Hebrews, such as we saw last week. But he informed them doctrinally in order to persuade them to adopt different attitudes and different actions. And remember that purpose we've put forward was that the author of Hebrews wrote to warn his audience to reject those Jewish teachings and to fix their eyes on Jesus. And today we're coming to that first warning passage. And the first warning, don't neglect Jesus. Okay? And so let's go ahead and look at Hebrews chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. I'm going to go ahead and read the whole thing, verse 1 through 4, which says this. Therefore, we must pay much closer attention to what we have heard, lest we drift away from it. For since the message declared by angels proved to be reliable, and every transgression or disobedience received a just retribution, how shall we escape if we neglect such a great salvation? It was declared at first by the Lord, and it was attested to us by those who heard, while God also bore witness by signs and wonders and various miracles and by gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed according to his will. All right, now that is the warning passage today in its entirety. But I want you to first note this. The verse begins with what word? Therefore. Now, so as not to sound like a broken record, because I feel like I've mentioned this a billion times before, too late, Jared, what is the therefore, therefore? Right? We always have to ask ourselves that question. Well, again, since we've discovered that Jesus, the Son of God, is better than the angels, we ought to then pay even more attention to his message. F.F. Bruce, commentator, says, "The truths and teachings of the gospel must not be held lightly. They are of supreme moment. They are matters of life and death, and must be cherished and obeyed at all costs. Now, let me remind you, the church of these Hebrews were suffering under persecution. And so that temptation was to take the easy way out. To say, this is too hard. This road is too hard. There is too much persecution and suffering. I'm going to take the easy way out. I'm going to go back to Judaism. Because then I won't feel that persecution and that suffering. Right? It's similar to what Jesus says to the church of Ephesus in Revelation 2:4, where he says this, "But I have this against you, that you've abandoned the love that you had at first." Okay, you've abandoned that love. Why? Again, persecution is too hard. I can't handle this. Well, today, church, what might cause us to drift away or abandon that first love? Would people say that of us? Would they look at our church family, our body, or even us as individuals and say, "Yeah, you know, I think at one time they were excited about Jesus. They were passionate about him. They loved him. They wanted to do his will and his work. But now it just seems like they're just not so fervent anymore." What happened? What did we lose that first love? Now, the Ephesian church and the Hebrew church here were literally, it says, drifting away, okay, lest we drift away from it, right? And the imagery there is hard to see, but it's actually that of a ship. How many of you, did anybody own a ship?
No one
does. Or you have a boat. What happens if you don't anchor that boat or tie it off? What does it do? It drifts away, right? All of a sudden, you're out on the sea. Row, row, row your boat gently down, and you're like without a paddle. Up a creek without, anyway. So, but it just drifts, right? The verb to pay attention, actually there, is used of bringing a ship to land. And again, if you don't tie that ship down securely, it will drift away. And the same is true of you and I if we don't pay attention closely, carefully. Because see, here's the issue. Most of the time, it's not even intentional. Our drifting isn't like one day we wake up and say, "Oh, today, guess what? I'm going to drift away from Jesus." Because that's a really good choice to make, right? Like, that's what we do. We wake up in the morning, we decide, "I'm going to drift today. Today is my day of drifting." No, that's not what we do, right? Obviously. But what happens is it's unintentional. We let our guard down. We let those lines kind of slacken, if you will, and the next thing you know, we have drifted away. Maybe it's just that we're so busy, we don't have time for God. Anybody ever heard that excuse before? Anybody ever given that excuse? "I just don't have time. I'm too busy. I have too many things going on in my life. I'll get back to it when I'm not so busy." Well, guess what? Are you ever not going to be so busy? How many of you are retired? How many of you are more busy now that you're retired than you were when you worked? Okay, good. All right. Prove my point right there. So you will never not be busy. So we can't use busyness as an excuse to drift from this relationship, right? Perhaps it's just that time has really just gotten away from us. Or, sadly, what if familiarity has bred contempt? Like, "Oh man, I know all these stories. I've been to church since I was like knee-high to a grasshopper. I've heard it all before. That preacher in the pulpit, he thinks he's got these new things to say. But the reality is there's nothing new under the sun," right? And so he's not really saying anything new. So why should I don't need to listen. I don't need to do this anymore. Wow, okay, The word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. And if it pierces and divides and you know gets in there, It's working today, and we should allow it to work today. And so we should never be at a place where we think, "Oh, I've learned it all, I've made it," because nobody likes a know-it-all, right? And so that is what it is. But then we'll find ourselves lost at sea, tossed about by the wind and the waves, rather than anchored safely in the harbor. Another commentator, R. Kent Hughes, said this: "The drifting that comes through the combination of years, familiarity, and busyness often bears its existence when the storm of opposition comes." When we face that opposition, if we've allowed ourselves to drift, guess what's going to happen? We'll have no anchor. That anchor has long been loosed, and when the winds come, an eternal soul is suddenly on the rocks and shipwrecked. No wonder, then, that the warning is a powerfully phrased command that should be read with an exclamation point, he says. "Therefore, we must pay closer attention, even more so, to what we've heard, lest we drift away from it, exclamation mark. In 2007, how many years ago was that? Kids, were you born in 2007 yet? My daughter was two. Anyways, yes, all right, I did the math. The band Casting Crowns, anybody know the band Casting Crowns? Okay, contemporary Christian band. They wrote a song called Slow Fade. It's a slow fade when you give yourself away, right? And that's the chorus. It says this, it's a slow fade when you give yourself away. It's a slow fade when black and white have turned to gray and thoughts invade and choices made. A price will be paid when you give yourself away. And I love this next line. It says, people never crumble in a day. People never crumble in a day. It's a slow fade. It's a slow fade. And that's the truth. People rarely crumble in a day. Again, like we don't get up in the morning and say, today I'm going to reject Jesus. I'm going to neglect this salvation. I'm going to go against him. I'm not going to do this or not do that. C.S. Lewis remarked, as a matter of fact, if you examine 100 people who had lost their faith in Christianity, I wonder how many of them would turn out to have been reasoned out of it by honest argument. He says, most people simply just drift away. Of course, that doesn't mean that there isn't forgiveness for those of us who have blown it by letting our guard down. But who wants to be shipwrecked on the sea? Who wants that? Hopefully, none of us want that. It's not like I desire to drift away from Jesus so that I can have this come back to Jesus moment, right? When I was a kid, I used to go up to camp all the time, and every summer I would rededicate my life to Jesus, sometimes two or three times during that week. Because I needed more. And it wasn't until I grew and I realized, no, this is every day. This is every day giving my life to Jesus. I can't just do it at camp. I can't just do it on Sundays or Wednesdays or whenever else. But it's an ongoing, all the time, relationship with Christ. And so pay attention, the word says. Okay? And why do we pay attention? Well, here we see in verse 2, that this message declared by angels was reliable. The author uses one of those stylistic things we talked about during the introduction. He uses some weird words. One is in Latin, a fortiori, if you know Latin, or if you know Hebrew, it's kalv wahomer, which basically means light and heavy. This argues from the lesser to the greater, saying that if something is true in the lesser, how much more so is it true in the thing that is greater? Now, the message declared by the angels, as we determined last week, was the Mosaic Law. Right? The angels were present and declared from God the law to Moses. And note that law, it says, is reliable. It depicts reality, and it carried with it a sense of firmness. Now, the firm reality was every sin is justly punished, right? That's what the law revealed, that there is punishment for sin. It revealed sin in the first place, and then the punishment therein. It was a revelation, really, of the justice of God. And so when he mentions that every transgression and every disobedience is justly punished, he's talking about both what we would call sins of commission, which are basically anything that we do that goes against God's law, doing the things that the law prohibits, and then the sins of omission, which is basically not doing what we're supposed to do or what the law told us to do. And so he's really saying this all-encompassing thing. Look, the law, it revealed every sin. The things that you were not supposed to do and the things that you were supposed to do. And so there's no excuse. And it was reliable because if you broke that law, what happened? Punished, right? Busted. And so that was the reality of this law. It was reliable therein. Every sin was justly punished. Now, the law revealed a reality that wasn't always pretty, but it was a reality nonetheless. And at the end of that reality is just retribution or punishment. Now, that's the lesser, praise God, right? Because if that's all there is, we're kind of stuck, right? Because none of us can obey the law fully, right? We've all fallen short of the glory of God. There is no one without sin. All of our righteousness is as filthy rags before the Lord. And so he comes in now in verse 3, and he says, how shall we escape then if we neglect such a great salvation? Now, how shall we escape? That question, of course, is rhetorical. If we neglect the greater message of the gospel and the salvation that comes through the Son, which is greater, there is no escape. There is no way to Houdini our way out of this one. Okay? We are stuck. Jesus uses that same word neglect, translated here, pay no attention, in the parable of the wedding feast in Matthew chapter 22. In that parable, the king invites the guests to the wedding of his son. And what do? I got to go do this. I got to go do that. They don't pay attention. And so then Jesus says, okay, you're done. I'm going to invite other people in to the banquet. And these people who neglected it received their punishment. Now, Calvin says it's not only the rejecting of the gospel, but even the neglecting of it that deserves the severest penalty in view of the greatness of the grace which is offered in it. You see, friends, I don't want to neglect good things in my life because I know what will happen to those things. So if I neglect my children, what's going to happen? It's not good, right? If I neglect my health, what's going to happen? Not good, right? So if I neglect this salvation, if I neglect my relationship with Christ, what is going to happen? It's not good. Dennis Johnson said, if the law delivered by Moses by angels mandated just punishment for its violators, an unspeakably graver penalty must await those who disregard the message of salvation now spoken through God's Son. And this is now the first of three proofs of the greatness of this message. See, I knew this guy was a good Baptist preacher. Three things. Why is this message greater? Why can we trust this message even more? And why then should we not neglect it as we are prone to do? Number one, this message was declared by Jesus himself. While the prophets proclaimed the message in advance, Jesus was the one to first declare this finished message, this great salvation. Mark 1, 14 through 15 says, now after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee, proclaiming the gospel of God and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. And so he declared it in his ministry here on earth. And in Hebrews chapter 1, 2, which we saw before, it said that he's spoken to us by his Son. And then later on in Hebrews 12, 2, we see that he is called the founder or the author of our faith. And so why is it a greater message? Because the greatest one, Jesus, is who declared it. And notice also they use the title Lord. The Lord is the one. It was declared first by the Lord. Hewitt said, the superior dignity of this new mediator is shown by the use of that title, Lord. And Philip Hughes said, the good news of salvation then derives from the Lord, whose mediatorship is absolutely other than that of the angels. It is the exalted Lord himself who brings this message. Now, if we saw that, if we were there and we sat at his feet and realized that he was Lord, wouldn't that change our lives? Wouldn't that change our lives? Right? So the Lord is the one who did this. He's the one who brought this message. It was declared by him. 1 Timothy 2, 5 through 6 says, for there is one God, and there is one mediator between God and men, the man Jesus Christ, who gave himself as a ransom for all, which is the testimony given at the proper time. So his very life as well was a declaration of this salvation. Okay, so it was declared by Jesus. Secondly, it was witnessed by the disciples. That second proof of the greatness of the message is the testimony of the eyewitnesses, or maybe we should say ear witnesses. That's not a word. Those who had heard the message. Both author and audience received the testimony from these eyewitnesses. Now, the Greek verb for attested conveys this sense of assurance, confirmation. It's actually related to that word used before. That's the word reliable, the reliable message of the law. So if the law was reliable, how much more so is this message of the gospel? Now, the beginning of the gospel, I got some like spirit in me today. But anyways, the beginning of the gospel of Luke sets forth this same argument to prove what he is writing is true. You guys know the beginning of the gospel of Luke, Luke chapter 1:1-4. It says, "Inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile a narrative of the things that have been accomplished among us, just as those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and ministers of the word have delivered them to us, it seemed good to me also, having followed all things closely for some time past, to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, that you may have certainty concerning the things you have been taught." And friends, you and I may have certainty that the message declared by the Lord and witnessed by the apostles is greater than the law. Okay? So that was point two. Now, point three, that it's confirmed even by God himself, right? Obviously, we know Jesus is God, but this is confirmed by God in three actual ways. And if those two reasons, like I said, weren't enough, God bore witness, as Jesus attests to in John 5:36-37. He says, "But the testimony that I have is greater than that of John. For the works that my Father has given me to accomplish, the very works that I am doing, bear witness about me that the Father has sent me. And the Father who sent me has himself borne witness about me." And he does this in two ways. The author of Hebrews mentions two profound ways. Number one, he does it through signs and wonders and miracles. These three terms are closely related. R. Kent Hughes defines them simply this way. Signs pointed beyond themselves to the mighty hand of God. Wonders brought awe and amazement to those who saw. And miracles, or literally powers, showed the power of God beyond human ability. Now, Scripture is full of accounts of Christ and also the apostles through his name doing wonderful miracles as proofs of this, the reliability of this message. Signs and wonders are mentioned together 11 times in the New Testament. All three of them are mentioned together in Acts chapter 2, verse 22. They make that same argument that Hebrews makes here. It says, "Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves know." Now, when you add in that third ingredient of miracles, it's a recipe that packs a punch, right? It's a recipe that packs a punch. And that punch would reverberate, as we see later in Acts 2:43, awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And so it was attested through those signs, wonders, and miracles, but it was also attested through spiritual gifts as well. In addition to that larger scope, signs and wonders, this other witness to the greatness of salvation is the giving of spiritual gifts. Now, these are gifts given to individuals according to, as it says, what? The will of God. According to the will of God. All right? And we know that these gifts are given by the Spirit to use in the context of the church. 2 Corinthians 12:7, it says these are for the common good. Much can be said, probably, and should be said about the place of spiritual gifts within the body. This is not a spiritual gifts sermon today, though. And so it's enough to note that these spiritual gifts are given to us by the Spirit of God. And no man would be able to have these gifts if they were not given by him, and serves then as that final piece in the proof of the supremacy of the message of the gospel over the law. Because it's a power that we couldn't have in and of ourselves. Right? The proof, as they say, is in the pudding. Now, the application today is quite clear. It says it right there. Don't neglect Jesus. Don't neglect him. Don't neglect him in your personal life. Now, what does that mean? What do I need to do to not neglect him? Read your Bible. Pray every day. It's a simple message. It's a message we've been hearing since we were like four years old, right? Read your Bible, pray every day. You hear the old song? That's what we need to do. Yeah, how easy is it for us to allow that Bible to just sit on the shelf? How easy is it for us to not seek the Lord in prayer? How easy is it for us to not gather with his people? How easy is it for us to ... Right? And so we don't want to neglect these things. R. Kent Hughes says, the concern is not for those who reject the gospel, but for those who neglect it. The concern is for one's attitude, the one who has let the greatness of Christ slip away, the one who no longer marvels at the atonement, the one who no longer has a desire for the word, the one who really does not pray in his spirit, the one who is drifting back to where he came from and has little concern about his drifting. And so what are those ways today that we're tempted to neglect him in our spiritual lives? Because this passage serves as a warning against that. But then also, how about in our corporate worship? How about in our times together? We hear quite often what's going on in the church, you know, universal. What's going on in the church? Dennis Johnson said, for these Hebrew followers of Jesus who first heard this sermon, factors such as rejection by family, public shame, loss of property and freedom, or the threat of martyrdom may explain why some neglected meeting together. Such costs of discipleship still confront the global church today. What are those ways? What might cause us to get our eyes off of Jesus? Perhaps it's the desire to stay relevant, to make sure we look like the people around us so that people might be attracted and come join us. Well, if the gospel brings light and truth, shouldn't that attract people? So we don't have to change the message. We don't have to water down the message. We just have to preach it clearly and understand who the people are, right? And so we don't want to lower that down. In the 90s, a phrase was coined, a term was coined. It was called seeker-friendly or seeker-sensitive churches. And I get where they're coming from. I do, right? Because they realize that we do want to be welcoming and have new people come. But the problem they're in was that they tried to do it by watering down the message of Jesus Christ. And we can't do that, okay? And so we got to fix our eyes on him. We got to keep making sure that the word of God is preached accurately and taught accurately in our Sunday school classes, our life groups, our children's and youth programs. We got to make sure that we're fixing our eyes on him, okay? So that we don't become like the rest of the world. How many of you know the hymn, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing? It's one of my favorite hymns. I actually had it sung at my wedding. it's just one of my favorites. Now, there's a story that comes along with this hymn. The composer, Robert Robinson, was actually converted under the mighty preaching of George Whitefield, great evangelist, right? And this guy just gave his life to Jesus. But later it says that he drifted from the Lord. He had been used as a pastor, but neglected these spiritual things and actually led him astray. And so in an attempt to find some peace, he began to travel the world. And during one of his journeys, he met this young woman who was evidently very spiritually minded. And she came up to him and had this conversation with him. And she asked him this question. She said, what do you think of this hymn that I've been reading? And she handed him the book. What hymn do you think it was? Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. It was his own hymn. Okay? And she asked him, and so he actually tried to avoid her question, but it was hopeless, for the Lord was speaking to him, and he broke down. He actually confessed to her who he was and how he'd been living away from the Lord. But then, here's what the lady said, which I love. She said this, but these streams of mercy are still flowing. These streams of mercy are still flowing. The woman assured him, and through then her encouragement, Robinson was restored to fellowship with the Lord. See, it's easy to drift with the current, to just get our eyes fixed on other things, to just not securely tighten and fasten that thing, and just we drift away. It's a slow fade, and people don't crumble in a day. So friends, lest we crumble, and lest the Lord remove the lampstand, which, by the way, happened to those churches in Revelation, we need to keep our eyes fixed on him. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you and praise you for your deep love for us. We know that it is so easy for us to get our eyes fixed on other things, to drift away. We don't wake up one morning and just decide to do it. It just happens. Well, we don't want that to be so. And so help us, Lord. Help us to put this passage into practice, that we would pay much closer attention to the things that we've heard so that we don't drift away from them. That we not neglect this great salvation that was declared by you, proved by the miracles of your Father, attested to by spiritual gifts, eyewitnessed by your disciples and others. Lord, help us to not neglect you. We know we need you for that. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. As we come today, one of the ways that we don't neglect him is by celebrating communion together. I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward, Raj. And as Karen just plays and just take some time to reflect on that, please take one of the elements when it passes by. If you'd prefer not to get a plate and take one. I think we have some in the back that you could just go grab if you don't want all hands and stuff in there. I understand. But please take a piece of bread and take the cup and just hold on to it for a second, and then we'll bless it before you take it. Thank you. I love the song that Karen was just playing, Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. And you see, sheep can't really take care of themselves too well. They're not the smartest animals around. And so they need help and they need guidance. And the same is true of you and I, right? We think we're smart sometimes. We think we got it all together sometimes, but the reality is, maybe not so much. And so we need to look to the shepherd to provide us the things that we need so that we don't neglect it. And one of the things, obviously, that he provided us was his very body. The bread of life was broken for you and I. Lord, we thank you that you allowed your body to be broken. And the shepherd actually became the sheep, the lamb of God. Takes away the sins of the world. And so, Lord, we look to you, that author, that perfecter, the founder of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured that cross and scorned its shame. And now sits at the right hand of the throne of God. We look to you for strength in this time and thank you. Thank you for your body, which was broken. We pray this in Jesus' name. In that upper room, he took the bread and he said, this is my body broken for you. Please take and eat.
How thankful we are as we come to the Lord's table that we have a living Lord, a Lord who died, who shed his blood so that all of our sins could be forgiven forever. Hallelujah. A living Lord, a loving Lord who shed his blood for you and me. I don't know about you, but when the reality that Christ died for all of my sins forever, when that hit me years ago, what a revelation that was. I'm free. I belong to God through faith in Christ because of what he did at the cross. Heavenly Father, we rejoice in your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. We thank you that he gave of his life for us so that we might have fellowship with you, forgiveness of sin, and know that we will live eternally with you in your home in heaven. No other one but Jesus. Thank you, Father God, for Jesus. In his name, amen. That night in the upper room, he did take the cup and he said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you. Take and drink all of it in remembrance of me.
At this time, will you stand with us as we sing, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
Come thou fount of every blessing, to my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise his name, I'm fixed upon it, name of God's redeeming love. Oh, to grace how great a debtor, daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above.
I love that. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. And we know that he gives us his very Holy Spirit that acts as a seal unto the day of our salvation. Today, let us tie our mooring line and anchor ourselves to him. Fix our eyes completely on him. God bless you, family. May you go in his grace and his love today. And hopefully we'll see you back tonight, 5 p.m. over in the Fellowship Hall. Those who are watching at home, we love you. God bless you. We hope to see you soon. Go with his grace today, family.